God bless you, one and all. This is Pastor Dwight Williams. Thank you. Thank you for joining us again on another This Week's Manna. Well, I pray that God has been miraculously moving in your life. In, you know, when it comes to miraculous movements from God, wouldn't it be wonderful if we could determine at all times when God was going to move, how he was going to move, and what he was going to move with? You know, but unfortunately, we don't have that luxury. And I often say that if we did have that luxury, we would be God. But because we're not God, and we are susceptible to his divine providence, we don't always readily have the answer of when God is going to move, how he's going to move, or where he's going to move. But the promise that we do have is that he is a God of provision. You know, the same God that spoke to Abraham in Genesis 22 and 13, when Abraham was tasked with the challenge of sacrificing the very thing that God had promised him. The Bible says that when Abraham lifted his hand, he looked and said, "Behold, a ram in the thicket." In other words, in that point, God was his Jehovah Jireh, meaning that he was the God that provides. So listen, I challenge you to call someone that is in a tight spot looking for provision. Maybe they don't have money to eat. Maybe they don't have, I've gotten a bad prognosis from the doctor, and they're looking for God to come, but don't know which direction he's going to come. We want to talk about that on this week's Manna. Listen, call somebody, text them, let them know that this week's Manna is on the air. Stay with us. We'll be right back as we talk about the provision of the Lord. God bless you. God bless you. I want to say hello to my lovely wife, co-pastor and First Lady Dimple Williams. As well, I want to recognize the sacrifice of my stream team. Many of you, you don't know what lengths they go through in order to provide this live stream each week. The sacrifices that they put their bodies through. You know, you look at me on the front side, but you don't know the conditions that they have to endure in order to produce a wonderful program. And I want to let them know right now that none of their efforts go unrecognized. And I thank them so much, Brother Eric and Pastor Melody. They take out their time. And I don't want to just make the program about them, but I want to just let them know that I thank you. I thank you from the depths of my heart. I thank you for your time. I thank you from the depths of my heart. As well, I want to say thank you to the Fresh Wind, Fresh Fire family for your prayers as well. We are praying for the gatekeepers. I want to say a special God-felt thank you and encouragement to Sister Deborah Robertson in the transitioning of family member, friend, confidant, Chef Robert Robertson. As well, I want to thank those of you that were able to join us. Listen, let's turn our hearts to the Word. Genesis, the 22nd chapter, is where we're going to pick up our scriptorial text. Genesis, the 22nd chapter. We're going to Exodus, the 16th chapter. We're going to read it out of the King James Version. Our subject of what we want to deal with this week is, what is it? Recognizing your manna. What is it? Recognizing your manna. Can we just bow our heads as we invoke the presence of God into this live stream this week? Father God, we welcome your presence here. We ask even now, God, that you will allow our mouths, God, to be your megaphone, that you will allow us, oh God, to be a mouthpiece for you. I pray even now, God, that you will stretch out your hands, God, provision to that person, God, that sees no way, that provision to that person, oh God, that does not see a solution. I pray even now, God, that you will show yourself strong on that person's behalf. We thank you, we honor you, and because your word is already blessed, in Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right, let's go to the word of the Lord, shall we? Get your Bibles, whatever your reading apparatus is, whether it's your phone, your tablet, get your Bible and join me at Exodus, the 16th chapter. We're going to read it out of the King James Version. Join me there as we read from the word of the Lord. We're going to pick up this conversation. I invite you to go back and read the entirety of the 16th chapter, but we're going to pick up this conversation not quite in the middle of the conversation, but it is a conversation that has already started between the Israelites and their God. And you have Moses and Aaron that are in the mix or in between the Israelites and God. Verse 13 picks it up like this. It says, And it came to pass, I want to alert you right there, it did not come to stop. It did not come to end, but it came to pass. You ought to put that in the chat even now, that whatever I'm going through with, it is coming to pass me. Not to stay. I don't intend to stay here where I'm at, but it is going to pass. So it came to pass that even, listen to this, the quails came up and covered the camp. And in the morning, the dew lay round about the host. And when the dew that lay was gone up, behold, upon the face of the wilderness, there lay a small round thing, as small as the hoarfrost on the ground. If you would, if you can picture just these little thin wafer cookies, the scripture calls it coriander, a thin wafer type product. It says, and when the children of Israel saw it, listen to this, they said to one another, it is manna. For they wist not what it was. And Moses said unto them, this is the bread which the Lord hath given you to eat. This is the bread which the Lord hath given you to eat. That's where we pick up on our lesson. This is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat. Now, I want to alert you to something before we go into this lesson, before we pull out a couple of definitions. I want to alert you to something, that the thing that you must understand, the thing that you must put in your heart. David said, I've hidden the word in my heart that I might not sin against God. So the thing that you have to put into your heart, the thing that you have to settle in your spirit, number one, is that God is a God of provision. He is the God of provision. The disciples, when they asked Jesus to teach them how to pray, in Matthew, the 6th chapter, he says, here it is right here, give us this day our daily bread. In other words, Lord, you and you alone know what things that we are in need of, and our prayer to you is because what we pray in faith. And then the word of the Lord says like this, we already know that we have our request because we pray what is within his will. What is the will of the Lord? It is the will of the Lord to provide for all of your needs according to his riches in glory. So this is the thing that you have to settle in your spirit. Listen, it does not matter what position you're in life. It does not matter where you are in life. It does not matter what you are faced with. It does not matter the obstacle that you have to go through, around, over, under. You must settle in your heart, God, it is your will to provide for me. One scripture said, it's the Lord's good pleasure to give to us the kingdom. So the thing that you have, let me say it like this, the noisome pestilence that you must block out of your spirit is that God is going to leave me where I'm at, that God is not going to come through for me. You've got to settle it in your spirit. And listen, I pray that this blesses someone today, because all of us, at some point in our life, all of us are going through challenges. The reality of the matter is we cannot go to the next level. We cannot go to the next plateau unless we are tested on the plateau or the level that we're on right now. So all of us are susceptible to the challenges of life. But again, I have to drive that home. You have to settle in your spirit that God is a God of provision. He is our Jehovah Jireh, which means he is the God that provides. Now, here it is right here. The thing that we want to look at is recognizing his provision. The Israelites, they say here in the scripture, they says, when the Israelites saw it, verse 15, they said one to another, it is manna, pronounced in the Hebrew tongue, ma or mon, which simply means, what is it? I don't understand what this is. So can you imagine the Israelites? Here they are. Their complaint is to God. They have just been exodus out of Egypt on the 15th day of the first month. They carry along with them a month's worth of provision. Now here it is, they are going into the second month. And that they brought with them out of Egypt has begun to run out or run low. They don't have the surplus that they used to have. And along with that, now they are tired. You know, they've been traveling a whole month. They're going into the second month. Provision has gotten low now. Now they look to Moses and say, Moses, you have brought us out into Egypt to kill us. Isn't it true that many times when God leads us into a specific area, an area where we don't see provision, an area where, you know, you stand up and testify by what God told you to do. You stand up and testify about where God led you to. You stand up and you testify about what God told you. And then when you get into a place, sometimes provision is not readily available. It's in those times, just like the children of Israel, the Israelites here, the scripture says in the 16th verse, it says at the 16th chapter, excuse me, this is when the people begin to complain. Their complaint now arises to Moses. Oh my God, can you imagine? Can you imagine the complaints that the people bring to Moses, you know, accusing him of giving them the okey-doke, accusing them of painting, you know, a paradise when they're going through a wilderness? So they begin to complain to Moses to the point that they even want to stone him and kill him and Aaron for placing them in such a provision. What does Moses do? Moses does, as we see throughout the book of Exodus, he turns to God. He turns to God and he begins to pray to God on the behalf of this people. Praise to God that God will give them provision. Now, this is the thing that I want you to key in on. In Exodus, the 16th chapter, I want you to key into this. I'm going to read it out of the New Living Translation, chapter 16, verse 6. This is what Moses says to the people in answer to their complaint. Can I back up to verse 7? He says, in the morning, you will see the glory of the Lord, because he has heard your complaints. Don't miss that, sweetheart. The Lord's ears are not too heavy that he has not heard your complaint. I don't want to try to be too pious. Some of you may have a complaint. Some of you may have a petition. Whatever it may be, you know. There are some of us, we try to say, act like we are in a position where we never complain to God. Well, if that's where you want to be, then let's just say you're a petition. But whatever the case may be, Moses tells them, he said, the Lord has heard your complaints, which are against him, not against us. It is the Lord that has brought us here. So your complaint is not against us, it's against him. He says, what have we done that you should complain about us? Chapter 16, verse 8 says, then Moses added, the Lord will give you, listen to this. Here it is, this is the promise. Remember I said, you've got to settle in your spirit that God is a God of provision. Moses says to them, the Lord will give you meat to eat in the evening and bread to satisfy you in the morning. For he has heard all your complaints against him. What have we done? Yes, your complaints are against the Lord, not against us. Moses tells the children of Israel, he gives them this promise. He gives them this instruction from the Lord. He said, the Lord is going to provide meat for you. Now, I need someone just to, if you don't put it in the chat, if you don't scream it out loud, I need you through an affirmation through your spirit. I need you to say along with me, God is going to provide my daily bread. He's going to, in other words, what I'm simply saying, God is going to provide what things you have need of. Which brings us to our the meat of our lesson here. Because when the Lord did provide, it's seemingly like the children of Israel had forgotten the promise. So that on the next morning, when they awoke, after the dew had lifted up from the ground, There they see along the ground is this little flake looking cookie. And as they go out to it, they say, this is manna, meaning what is it? What is it? Forgetting about the promise, they look at their provision and say, what is this? Oh my God, is there anyone that is bold, brave, and brash enough to admit that there have been situations in your life that when your back was against the wall and you were looking for God to come in one direction, and because he came in another direction, your first retort to God is, Lord, what is this? This is not what I even asked for. I'm looking for you to touch somebody's heart to bring me some money. I'm looking for you to perform a miraculous healing. I'm looking for you to touch somebody's heart to meet whatever my need is. And sometimes God won't answer the way that you are expecting him to answer, but he is supplying your manna. So what we're saying in the lesson today is, what is it? Recognizing your manna. In other words, recognizing your provision. There may be times in your life where you actually miss the provision of God because you were expecting God one way when God came in a whole different direction. Many times we even charge God foolishly and say to God, Lord, didn't you hear my prayer? Didn't you hear what I was calling for? Because we don't receive it like God intends for us to have it. You know, I don't want to be lengthy with this because this could be a lengthy lesson. But I want to suggest to you, my dears and sirs, is that sometime when God sends provision, he does not readily answer your prayer. But what he does do is send you through a process that will train you in order not to get into that situation again. What am I saying? What are you saying, Pastor William? Many times what God does, he doesn't present our answer all wrapped up and bowled up in a box. Many times what God does, he sometimes extracts something or someone in order for us to see the provision of the Lord. Sometimes he even adds something to us in order that we might see the provision of the Lord. The prayer that we must pray, and you might want to put this in the chat, the prayer that we must pray, put it in the comments. Lord, help me to notice when you send manna, however the manna may be disguised. Lord, help me to notice when you send manna, no matter how it is disguised. Many times, God sends the answer. Might I remind us, even Daniel, in the book of Daniel, around somewhere between the 8th and the 11th chapter, Daniel begins to pray to God because of the offense that is launched against him. Daniel begins to pray to the Lord, and the Bible says that Daniel prayed 21 days. But do you remember what the angel of the Lord told Daniel? He said, Daniel, we heard you the first day that you prayed. He says, but between God getting the answer to you and your prayer, because of the attack that the enemy launched, the answer to your prayer was held up. Now, the thing that you've got to understand is, though that moment that you are waiting on an answer from God, those are the times that you must occupy until he comes. You say, well, Pastor William, you don't understand what I am faced with. I need an immediate answer. Well, sweetheart, might I suggest to you that your immediate answer may not lie in the immediacy, if that is a word. It may not lie in your answer being given at that moment. It may be that the answer to your problem is not instant gratification, but the answer to your problem is God enlightening you as to why you're in this position, and God giving you revelation on how not to be in this position again. But many times we miss it. Many times God sends the manna. We miss it because the manna is disguised in a manner that we do not recognize, because we, like the children of Israel, we are accustomed to praying to God and God sending the miracle just like it is. Well, the disadvantage of that is many times instant gratification does not teach you anything. Instant gratification, it does not send a resolve in your spirit. All it simply does is pull you out of the immediate moment. So what God is looking for, the provision that God is looking for, God wants to give you a not just instant provision, but he wants to give you a provision that will continually work. I want to show you something here in the word of the Lord. I want to show you something here. Let's go back to the 16th chapter of Exodus, and let's look at the fourth verse. It says, "Then the Lord said to Moses, 'Look, I am going to rain down food from heaven for you.'" He says, "Each day the people can go out and pick up as much food as they need for that day." Here it is right here. He says, "I will test them in this to see whether or not they will follow my instructions." What are you saying to me, Pastor Williams? I'm saying that sometimes when you're waiting on manna from God, when you're waiting on provision from God, many times what God is simply doing, God is just simply trying to see if you will follow his instructions. You know, sometimes they are instructions that we really don't want to hear. Sometimes they are instructions that challenge us. Sometimes they are very difficult instructions that call for us to make a decision that we really don't want to make, you know, to make a call that we really don't want to call. But as God is saying here in the scripture, he says, "I know the people need meat." He's saying they're looking for T-bone. They're looking for ribeye. He said, "But I'm going to give them a provision," he said, "because I simply want to find out whether or not you're going to follow my instructions." And here it is right here, sweethearts. You've got to understand this. Number one, God is a God of provision. Number two, God is a God. Here it is. Don't miss it. You might want to write this down in your notes. He is a God of process. He is a God of provision, and he is a God of process. God is not interested in being your sugar daddy. He's not interested in being your yes man. He is not interested in being your sponsor. What God wants to be, he wants to be your God. He wants to be the God that provides for you. But in God's provision, God wants to know, will you follow my instructions? The provision has been made, but God wants to know whether or not you'll follow his instructions. I got to go on here because I feel my time is growing out here. Can I give you just a couple of, I won't necessarily call them points, but I do want to suggest two things to you. Number one, Lord, help me to notice when you send manna. Number two, Help me to receive the manna that you present or that you provide with gladness. The first thing that I want to suggest to you, that it is amazingly easy to miss manna provision. I heard one person tell me, I think it may have been my godson that I've heard say this before. He says, let me quote him correctly. He says, "You'll always miss what you're not looking for." Thank you, Sister Melody. It's easy to miss what you're not looking for. What are you saying to me, Pastor William? When we're looking for provision, don't look for an easy way out. Look for provision. And see, many times we miss provision because we're not looking. We're looking for a way out. And my dears and sirs, understand that God said, "I am God, I'll never leave you, I'll never forsake you, but I'll be with you even to the ends of the earth." But what are you looking for? Are you looking for provision, or are you looking for a quick fix? And many times what the problem is, we miss the provision. We miss the manna because we're looking for a quick fix. We're not looking for God's provision. Another point that I want to suggest to you, you must affirm through your faith that God is going to help you. The scripture in the book of Romans says, all things work together for the good of them. And see, when we say all things, the only thing that we're referring to is our situations. We're not referring to the external parts that God is trying to plug into your situation. So when we say all things, we are numerically counting the things that we go through. When we say all things, we're not talking about what God is doing in every specific situation, but you got to understand, even sometime when it causes your hurt, all things. You've got to understand, you've got to affirm in your spirit that God is going to help me, so all things are working together, whether you've got to go through the pit in order to make it to the palace, whether you've got to go through the prison in order to be the prorator. Whatever God does in your life, you've got to settle it and affirm it in your spirit. It hurt me. I was like Jacob. I walked away with a limp, but it worked together for my good. David said it like this. He said, "It was good for me that I was afflicted." He said, because it was only then that I knew the word of God. Sometimes it's in those positions that we are placed in that we really find out our place in God. Another thing here is your provision usually comes. Oh, my goodness. Here's a big one right here. Your provision usually comes when you are a blessing to someone else. I challenge you with that. The thing that you're in need of, try sowing into someone's life the same thing that you are in need of, and watch God's provision. In other words, you be the blessing to someone else of the blessing that you need. You say, "Well, Pastor William, listen, I got this bill due. I only have X amount of money in order to pay this bill." Try sowing a seed. Can I take you back to the book of Malachi here? The book of Malachi says, "Prove me now that I will not open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing." More than just tithes, but it is the obedience of recognizing God in my giving. The very thing that I have need of, I need $20 for gas, but I'm gonna turn around and give somebody else 10. Of my 20. Your provision, many times, it will come when you are a blessing to someone else. Now, my dears and sirs, might I suggest to you that it's according to your faith. Now, hear what Moses said. Moses said, "Your complaint is not against me. You complain against God. So listen, don't step out on Pastor Dwight Williams. Step out on what the Lord said. Because if God didn't tell you to do it, listen, baby, you better stay where your faith is. But I will say to you that when you are a blessing to someone else, the word of the Lord affirms what I'm saying. It says, be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man, here it is, soweth, that shall he also reap. Whatever you sow, God will in turn bless you. Now, I hope you don't think that those scrapes that you came through, I hope you don't think that those tight spots that you came through were always predicated simply on your walk with God. Because the reality of the matter is, sometimes our walk is not where it should be. But sweetheart, can I suggest to you, you don't even realize it, but God was a blessing to you because of what you did 2 months ago when you saw someone else in need. God was a blessing to you last year when you provided for someone when you really didn't even have it. But you provided to someone. God is now providing for you. You've got to understand the ability to recognize your manner. I got one more here and then I'm going to leave this alone. We've already stated that the need for manner is always a test to see if we will follow God's instructions. Sweethearts, can I tell you this? God knew where you were, or God knew where he knows where you are before you even got there. He is a God, according to the book of Isaiah, the 40th chapter, he is a God that works from the end back to the beginning. In other words, God preps the end of your story, and then he works back to the beginning of your story. In other words, God said, "This I already fixed this up for you. I knew the children of Israel were going to need manna. I knew they were going to need to go through a Red Sea. I knew, that they were going to need water." God already knows. So where you are on God's barometer, where you are on God's map scope, God said, "I already know your point of destination. I already know the red spot on the map. You are here." God said, "I already know." But what God is trying to do, God is trying to prep you to get you where you need to be. All I'm simply saying to this is, my dears and sirs, is he is a God of provision. Start speaking to yourself, asking God, "Lord, show me how to notice those times when you provide manna. I don't understand this situation. What is it, God?" God is saying it's manna disguised. It's your provision, and you don't even know it. And many times, because we don't know it, we don't recognize, we'll walk away from it. We'll walk away from what God is trying to provide us with. Glory to God. But sweetheart, listen, he is a God of provision. He is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all you can even ask or think. It's according to the power, though, that worketh in you. I'm going to leave this alone. This has been great. This has been wonderful. This has been good. I pray that you have been blessed, strengthened, encouraged, and challenged through the word of God. Can we pray? Can we pray? I want to pray for someone that's in that position right now. And I know it's easy to talk on the front side when you're not the person in the situation. But I pray that this has been an encouragement to use to help you to catch hold to faith and know that God will do exactly what he said he would do. Father, it is in the name of your son, Jesus, that we pray. We thank you even now because you are God yesterday, today, and you are the same God forevermore. So God, I pray even now that if you provided for Abraham, if you provided a ram in the thicket for Abraham after he had successfully gone through his test, be the same God in our situation. There's some mother whose back is up against the wall. She cannot provide for her children. There's some father that has lost his job and not able to continue to provide for his household. There's some individual that the doctor has shaken their heads and say, we can do no more. But God, I know that you are a God of provision. So I pray even now, God, that you would show yourself strong on that person's behalf. And then, God, there's someone that desires to give their life to you, and they really don't know if they can live a life for you, God. I pray even now that you would show that person your provision. Reveal the manner in their life, God, in the name of Jesus. And God, we thank you and we honor you. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. God bless you, sweetheart. I pray that you enjoyed it this week. I did. I pray that you enjoyed it. Listen, I invite you to tune in again next week for another This Week's Manna. And listen, for those of you that don't have a church home, baby, get yourself to church. I invite you to come join us at Fresh Wind, Fresh Fire Ministry. We'd love to have you. Come with us, fellowship with us, be with us as we lift up the name Jesus. This is Pastor Williams saying to you again, until we meet again, God keep you is our prayer. God bless you.
Thank you for tuning in. We pray that this message has been a blessing to you and your family. If you would like to seed into our ministry, or if you would like to visit our social media platforms, or simply want to be in service with us in person, all of that information is located to the left of the screen. Remember, let's be great.